today. We pray, Father, that it would do what your word always constantly does. It would make us better. That it would challenge us. It would develop us. It would take us to a brand new place. It would challenge us. It would push us at times to do the things that you were calling us to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So as we start this morning, I just want you to ask your neighbor, what are you crying for? You can go and ask your neighbor that. What are you crying for? You know, I remember when I was a little kid, and you know, I used to always hang out with my cousins. And you know, when one of them used to cry, you know, maybe we gave them a reason to cry. Maybe we didn't. Maybe it was the little punch that we gave them in the arm. Some of you guys are laughing right now because you know exactly what I'm talking about. You used to pick on your little cousin, your little brother, your little sister. And what was the first thing you would say once they began to cry? What you crying for? Well, duh, I'm crying because you just hit me. Or maybe you're that little kid that was being picked on. If you need counseling afterwards, we have counselors that will be available up front who can talk to you and walk you through the struggles of being picked on as a little cousin or a little brother or a little sister. And we would make sure to pray for you in a special way. But whatever the case is that you might have even been asked the question. And as you sit there, you're like, you know why I'm crying. I'm crying because you hit me. I'm crying because you hurt me. I'm crying because you called me a name. I'm crying because you didn't take me to the store with you, me, or take me to the store with you. You know, you had a reason to cry that motivated and pushed you. And so ask your neighbor again, what are you crying for? Oh, you guys are not working with me today. You guys are not working with me today. Come on. Look at your neighbor real quick and say, what you crying for? Yeah, maybe with even a little bit of an attitude. You know, just a little bit of a, what you crying for, you know? You know, to be honest with you guys, I mean, I don't know how many men would actually stand before you and actually say this to you, but I'm going to tell you guys, let you guys into a little secret of mine. I am a crier. And I'm not talking about one of those normal criers, you know, that looks cute. I am a nasty, ugly crier. I'm talking about, like, you know, emotions start going, my hair starts flinging, and you know, no. But no, snot starts coming down my nose, it's loud, sometimes even like a, you know, like that type of thing. You know, I am a loud, noisy crier. And what I believe in a sense, as we look at the, you know, the scripture today, and as we go through what I'm talking about today, is that I feel like God is calling us to be those who cry. And it's not just crying over anything, everyone, or anything, or all the circumstances of our life, but we are to cry specifically for particular things. That there's things in which that we should be moved about, like in the sense that, you know, there should be a driving force inside of us that pushes us and that motivates us to cry out to God. To cry out for God to bring change, whether it's inside of our neighborhoods, or whether it's inside of our own personal life, or whether it's in the life of someone else where we stand in the gap for them, where they don't have a clue about what's going on in their life, but we can stand in the middle of their situation and lift up a cry up to God and say, God, I love you. God, I just pray that you would bring breakthrough inside this area. God, I pray that you would give this person strength. God, I pray that in the middle of the circumstance in which they're dealing with, that you would provide peace, is that there shouldn't be just this quietness or this calmness that exists inside of all of our lives, but yet there needs to be a point in time where we ask ourselves and we ask those around us, what are you crying for? What is the thing that is driving you to your knees? And is it the right thing? Is it the thing in which God is calling you or wants you to be crying out for? You know, I have a how old is she now? Just 16 months daughter, right? And now she's kind of running around. She kind of gets into everything. She's like everywhere. I mean, when I say everywhere, I mean everywhere. She doesn't put things away. She takes everything out. So if there's something inside of a cabinet, she grabs everything, and what she believes is she organizes it on the ground so that we know the stuff that we have inside that drawer or inside that cabinet. Okay, she is an organizer. That's what we like to say. Put a positive spin on it. She is an organizer for us inside of our home. But my daughter doesn't cry too much. But there are moments when she does. I remember when she was a little bit younger, you know, I would be holding her, I'd be playing with her, I'd be doing something, and all of a sudden she just would start crying. And I would be like, why is she crying? Why is she crying? And all of a sudden her mom walked in the room and said, oh, she's crying because she's hungry. She's crying because inside of that moment, inside of that time, she has a desperate need that needs to be filled. And so me, I'm kind of trying to hold her. I'm trying to do all the things that need to do as a father, but there's nothing that I can do to soothe her. Why? Because what she's crying for is food. What's driving her is a hunger. And I guess one of my other questions for you is, what are you hungry for? What is driving you to cry out? And I'm telling you that just as when I give my daughter to my wife and my wife begins to feed her, all of a sudden a satisfaction comes over her, that we can have that same satisfaction when we go to God with the things in which that are hungry inside of us to see change inside of our communities, to see change inside of our lives, to see change inside of our families. Because I'm telling you right now, the reason why it's on your mind today is because God is putting a hunger inside of you to be the avenue of change.
Yes.
You know, just recently, you know, and I was going to get the video from YouTube, but I couldn't find it. But my wife and I are planting a church in Vallejo, okay? Now, it's very interesting that ever since we decided we're planting a church in Vallejo, that there has been an incident almost every single month inside of Vallejo. Vallejo can't stay off of ABC News. And I'm driving around town being like, knucklehead, stay off the news. People don't need to know that we're even here. But every single month, there's been at least one thing. This past school year, about three months ago, we had a young man that was walking around he actually left school, he left high school. They don't really know why he left, but they're saying that he left off the high school, and within maybe like 50 feet of the high school, he runs into someone, and they believe that it possibly might have been gang-related, or it might have been a drug thing, whatever. He gets shot, and he dies inside of a ravine that is like, as you walk along in Vallejo. Okay? A week later, or maybe like a month later, we hear about, I'm sitting at the hospital, and a car drives up. It's a woman inside the car, and as she's driving into the emergency room parking lot, there's two cops behind her. Now, you know that she had been chasing them for a while, because the first thing they did when they stopped by the car is they got their hands on their hips, and they were saying, be still. She yells at them and goes, stop, 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 stop. I have someone in the back that has just been shot. Well, their reaction went from this to, oh, how can we help you? And when they basically got a guy who had been shot up outside of her back seat. This lady's daughter is in the back seat also screaming her head off. And I'm sitting there looking at this circumstance, looking at this situation, and I'm like, dear God, what do you want us to do? And it's inside of that moment when, and to kind of end with that story so you know exactly what happened. What had happened was, I guess someone had got mad at somebody else and drove by their house and shot up their grandmother's house, which everybody was in. And it's inside the circumstance where I'm kind of like, oh God, what is it that you want us to do? And even a month after that, we're on the news because one of the other local high schools was shut down twice in one day. They even had footage of literally a fight breaking out, and these young people are just going at each other, just fighting, throwing. And I don't know what reaction comes up inside of your mind, because it ain't your city, so it ain't your problem. But guess what? It's my city and it's my problem. But literally every single time that I watch that video or hear about some of this thing, my heart begins to break. my attitude begins to be transformed. I go from being happy and all joyful to all of a sudden now I'm like, God, oh God, I need you to do something. God, oh God, I need you to use me in a mighty way. God, oh God, bring transformation into my life. Because why? Because I feel as though God is calling us to be people that don't just talk about issues, not just people who sometimes put our behavior or our activities on the line, but we're people literally every single day that are crying out to Him on behalf of people that cannot cry out for themselves. And the thing is I was going to preach this other message. This is part of the message I was going to preach, so I'm going to tell you a little bit about it. But there is a scripture where in Jeremiah chapter 31, where it is a prophecy about the future. And what God says about Jeremiah, He goes, one day the watchman will be restored that was in Ephraim. And literally, what does that mean? And I'm feeling like, God, what does that mean? You know, and this is what the Holy Spirit, you know, just, you know, through commentary, looking online, looking through books, all this stuff, I discovered Ephraim was the place that sat between the two countries. If you know anything about the Bible, you know that Israel at one time was one country, and then you start reading, all of a sudden you see that it's two divided countries. It means that there's two ideas of thought that are functioning, but yet it wasn't God's intent for them to be divided. It was God's intent for them to be united. But what God is doing is God is speaking to him. And literally when God is speaking to him, He's telling him that these countries will one day be united, which is awesome, which is amazing. Because when you know when there's unity inside of a place, transformation is able to take place. But in order to bring unity, you've got to change the way people think. You've got to change the way people act. You've got to change the way that people do the things in which they do on a daily basis. And what they actually say defines who they are. And so when you understand that, and when you look at that, you see that God is entering into a situation and He's saying that it will no longer be divided, but it shall be united. And when it is united, you have people that are on the same page. You have people that think differently than what they used to think. And I don't know about y'all, but that should excite you, because what that means is that whatever you're faced with right now, whatever the challenges that you're facing, that guess what? God can bring change inside of a moment. That the Holy Spirit can enter into someone's life, and all of a sudden the way that they used to act, they don't act that way no more. The way that they used to talk, they don't talk that way anymore. The way in which they used to maybe even dress, they don't dress that way anymore. Why? Because the Holy Spirit has entered into the situation, and He's not into dividing us, but God is into uniting us. I mean, that is exciting. I mean, that is such an amazing thing, as if you think about it. And so literally, what God said to me, He goes, the reason why so many communities are wrecked is not because of necessarily what the people are doing inside of the community. It's wrecked because the watchman on the wall decided to get down. Because the person that is supposed to be crying out and praying for that community, being the person that stands up in the midst of whatever happens, has left the community. And it's a challenge for us as Christians to think a little bit differently. Because a lot of times what we think is, well, God has blessed me. God wants me to have that bigger house in the suburbs. So I'm moving out of what would be called the ghetto or what would be called the inner city. And guess what? I'm pursuing something else. But what you've just done inside of that moment is you just have removed God from the equation. And the thing is that God is calling us to be people, despite the things that are going on inside of our situation, inside of our schools, inside of our environment, not to be the ones that run, but to be the ones that stand up and say, you know what? The Holy Spirit has led me here. God is guiding me here. God has brought me to this place, not just to just be here and just to do nothing, but to be here and to be a watchman, to be someone who cries out, to be someone who says, I will heal a community. Yes. And it's the thing of, it's not you healing the community, but it's God through you. Amen. That is healing that community. Amen. Let me get back to my notes, because I don't want to preach another sermon. So one thing remains, you know, as I think about my daughter and I think about what satisfies her is the hunger that is driving her inside. Is the question for you is, do you have a hunger to see God move? You have hunger to see a revival take place. Are you hungry to see a community transformed? Are you hungry to see an individual walk inside of this building who has never walked inside of here before? Or are you hungry for someone's life to be so transformed by the love and by the presence of God that you're willing even to buy that coffee for them? Or are you even willing to even invite them to church? What are you hungry for? Because what you're hungry for will determine where you go in your life. What you hunger for, desire, will determine what it is that you cry for. And in turn, will determine what you get. Or as the Bible says, what our fruit will be. When she cries, my little daughter, I give her to Genesis, my wife. What happens when we cry? Where do we turn to? What comes to us? When you begin to cry late at night that for the things that you know that nobody else knows about, what comes to you? A phone call from a guy you're not supposed to be talking to? What comes to you? Someone else speaking negativity over your life? Or is it the things of God? Is it the fact that as you begin to cry out to God, all of a sudden he leads you to a particular scripture and you begin to read that scripture, or he leads you to a particular website and you hear an amazing message from some pastor, or you open up your computer and you go to your email because you're driven by the Holy Spirit to be there, not driven by your desires that are uncontrolled, but are you being driven towards something that is actually going to produce life inside of you? It says from the Bible, we know that God hears and sees our tears. In 2 Kings, this is that verse I told you to go to, just in case you think, oh, he's not preaching Bible. Well, here I am right here. It says, turn back and say to Hezekiah, the leader of my people, thus says the Lord, the God of David, your father, I have heard your prayers. I have seen your tears. Behold, I will heal you. On the third day, you shall go up to the house of the Lord. I have heard your tears. I have seen them. And guess what? I am moving on your behalf. So if you want to move God, you have to know how to cry for the right things. Here goes another verse, Psalms 56, 8. It says, you have kept count of my tossing, but my tears, and put my tears in a bottle. Are they not in your book? In other words, what he's saying is, as I've stored up those things in which you're crying about. And the thing is that so many of us are just crying for a car. We're just crying for a house. We're just crying for a promotion. But God is saying, okay, I can give those things to you, but guess what? I want to give you nations. I want to give you an inheritance. I want to give you people. I want to give you more than just the material things, but I want to give you these people inside of your life for you to mold and for you to shape, for people inside of the next generation. I mean, how do you view these people? Do you view it as, oh, the young people are just crazy? Or do you view it as, oh my goodness, thank you for this opportunity. God, thank you for this moment. God, thank you for this time inside this season where I get to pour into these young people, where I get to pour into this community, where I get to pour into some of these folks that are knuckleheads and they don't think the way that they should think, but who cares? I'm going to love them anyway. Amen. The Bible is full of stories of people crying, but today I want to mention two things that we should always be soft towards or cry for. The first thing that we should always cry for is transformation within ourselves. You know, it's one thing to want change. It's another thing to actually to be a producer of change. You know, I just heard this recent quote, maybe Phil would add it to his repertoire. But it says that everybody wants to be a part of the revolution, but nobody wants to wash the dishes. And the idea is the fact that we can all say, yes, we're going to be there. Yes, I'm going to do, you know, yes, I want to do this. Yes, I want to do that. Yes, yes. I'll be in time and go this, and I'm going to just, yes, I just want to, yeah. But when people have conversations with us, we're rude, we're mean, we're evil, we're disrespectful, we're, you know, we're bitter about life, we're fearful, we've got so much doubt, we've got so much anxiety, and we're like, okay, well, we can take a pill for that. I'll just take a pill for that. I'll just, you know what, I'm going to take a pill for it. You know, and I'm just going to fix it
all in one moment. I don't care about everybody else, but I'm just gonna make a appeal. If I make a appeal, guess what? It'll be all right. Then guess what? I'll just all of a sudden be nice. No, you won't all of a sudden be nice. Guess what? You'll just be a zombie walking around. You'll just be someone who's not feeling anything, but at the same time, you haven't fixed the real issues, because guess what? You've turned to the pill instead of actually turning to God, who says, I am your creator. I am the one who inside your mother's womb formed you and molded you and shaped you. And guess what that means to me? That should at least give you a little bit of, you know, security in the sense that I messed up a little bit, but maybe I'm just messed up because God put something into me, and maybe I'm just using it the wrong way. So instead of using it that way, let me use it in this way. Because you have the things inside of you that God has molded, God has shaped you. That means His hand was upon your life when you were inside your mother's womb. No matter, even if your parents, they might have never been married, they might have never have planned for you, but guess what? God planned for you. You're not a mistake. You're not something that we can just throw away. You're not just someone who's just here existing just because, but you are here because God has positioned you for this time, for this season, and guess what? It is your place, and guess what? You might be the person that's thinking, what can I do? And I'm telling you, what can't you do? How can't you not get on your knees and just pray and just say, God, I seek your face for my life. God, I'm hurting. God, I don't know how to work it through this moment, but God, I need you to transform my life. God, I need you to come in the middle of what I'm going through. God, I need you to help me to deal with these desires and these things that I cannot control. God, I need transformation, not so that I can sit on the couch and say, oh, how good I am, but God, how much more could I do inside of my community if I'm being a healthy example to these young men that are running around? How much more of an example of how a healthy marriage can actually thrive inside of this country if I know how to treat my wife with respect, but it doesn't begin with her, it begins with me. I remember when I first got married, and all you ladies, you guys might hate me after this, but it's okay, because it's the truth. But I've worked through it, okay? So, but then again, you might love me because I've worked through it, you know? So, you know, I remember when I first got married, you know, me and my wife, the first year, I mean, it was rocky, dude. I mean, it was rocky. Phil, it was rocky. You know, I mean, it was rocky. I mean, it was like two worlds coming together, colliding. You know how you see that thing like on like the planets, you know, kind of revolutionizing, like, you know, a moon came out, you know, two things. It was bad. I mean, it was like, I don't even know how else I can even describe it. But you know, being the godly Bible student that I was, you know, knowing that change did not start with me, but it changed with her, and everything was really her fault, not my fault. You know, as you know, I feel like I needed to let God know that. You know what I'm saying? Like, God, this is my prayer. God, fix this woman that you've given to me. Lord, work on this woman. Oh, Lord, change the way she thinks. Change the way. Let her just read that scripture where it says, respect your husband. The other part of scripture says, husbands, love your wives. It doesn't say the wives are to love their husbands, which is very interesting in itself, but whatever. So I'm like, God! And I felt the Holy Spirit say to me, she's not the problem. You are. And I sat there and I was like, devil, get behind me, Satan. I was thinking like, oh my goodness, it must be the Holy Spirit that told me that. And so what happened was we went to marriage counseling. They did it for like a few months, and then all of a sudden, you know, my wife said, okay, it's your turn. And I said, well, when's going to be your turn? She goes, no, it's never going to be my turn. It's your turn to go by yourself. And so I went there by myself. And my counselor, who was a woman, kept saying to me, Teddy, you're holding back. And guess what? If you don't stop holding back, today will be your last session. And I'm thinking to myself, like, if I tell my wife it's my last session, I'm really going to be in trouble. So she walked me through some exercise. One of the exercises she walked me through was she had me close my eyes and she said, you know, what do you picture when you think about yourself? And I began to describe this picture to her. I said, well, when I think about myself, I think about a little boy who was actually cuddled up in a corner inside of a dark room.
And she goes, okay, that's good progress. She said, well, why do you feel that way? So we went through all the things that we walked through. Then we did another session, and she said, okay, I want you to picture that little boy. And she said, but what I also want you to do is I also want to let you know some things about what Jesus thinks about you. So she began to say, you are more than a conqueror. You are the head and not the tail. She began to say that Jesus formed you, or God formed you inside of your mother's womb. You are not a mistake. She began to just say transformational words to me over and over and over again. And then she goes like this, well, how do you see yourself now? I said, I still see myself the same exact way. And she goes, well, guess what? It's time for you to get up. And the thing is that inside of that moment, she goes, I want you to close your eyes. I want you to get rid of the darkness. I want the clouds to go away. I want the rain to go away. I want it to be lit up. I want you to stay there. Then I want you to begin to stand up on your feet. As you begin to stand up, begin to raise your arms, begin to open up your eyes and declare over your life that you are no longer that little boy inside of a corner. But guess what? You are a man who is victorious. Yeah. And I guess the whole thing is that it begins with you crying out to God and saying, God, I give myself to you. God, I give you all of me. I give you the part that I don't like. I give you the part that my wife don't like. I give you the part that I like. I like give you the part that she likes. I give you every single part of who I am. And God, come and bring change inside of my life. Mark chapter 10, verse 26 through 27 says, and they came to Jericho. And as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, which sitting by the roadside, was sitting by the roadside. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out, saying, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And the thing is that if we never learn to cry out to God, then guess what? The breakthrough that we're believing for, it might not ever happen. I would even go to say that it won't ever happen. Because guess what? If it was meant to happen, it would already happen inside of your own means, by your own strength, by your own abilities. But God wants you to know that we have to cry out just as this beggar cried out. That literally when Jesus was coming his way, he didn't say, well, maybe it's not the right timing for God yet. Or maybe it's not my season yet. Oh, well, maybe it's just, you know, maybe I've got to wait till the moon's line up and the sun's doing this and that's happening over here till I have the cutest outfit, to where I have the right shoes, where I can go get my hair cut and then get right with Jesus. Because, you know, when you're at the altar trying to get right with Jesus, you know, people be seeing the back of your head, and I can make sure I got a cool fade up so that nobody talks about me. No. He didn't say all that. What he said was, you know what? My opportunity has come, and guess what? I've got nothing to lose, because guess what? I'm already blind. I'm already messed up. I already got some issues. And the thing is that some of us are so blind to the things happening inside of our lives, and we keep wondering why we keep getting in that type of relationship, why we keep having that financial situation. It's because we're spiritually blind, and inside of the situation, instead of us saying, I'm blind, what we like to do is we like to walk around, I'm wearing sunglasses. Oh, look how beautiful I am. Oh, look how amazing I am. No, stop the facade and realize that God wants to touch you, that today is your moment. Yeah. This is your season, that this is your opportunity. You know, I remember it was when I was little, I had a cousin, and you know, we talk about people when they ain't here, so good, you ain't here, you come to church, you know what I mean? You don't talk about, whatever. Come to church, you don't want to talk about, but whatever. So I had a cousin, right? She might have been like 10 or 11 years old. Well, she had this desire to get a haircut like all of her cousin, boy cousins. So like me and like her brother, she wanted to get a haircut like us. So what she did, all the family downstairs, she's upstairs, she takes a razor and she goes zzz, and she, I guess she got to about right there and then realized, oh, this ain't cute. And so then what she did was she proceeded to actually, she took like a jacket or a blanket or something, she put it over her head, you know, like, you know, Little Red Riding Hood, and she comes downstairs and we're like, what are you doing? She goes, I'm a superhero. And she had even like tied a little thing on to it so that it wouldn't fall off. I'm a superhero. I'm a superhero. And you know me, I'm being smart mouth. I was actually that cousin that actually punched you and said, what are you crying for? That was me, okay? So you gotta realize I really wasn't that compassionate towards her. What I said to her was, because I said there, superheroes don't have no hood on. They just have capes on. What are you doing? Put it down. Put the cape down like that. If you want to be a superhero, be a real superhero. Don't be a fake superhero. Who are you, Little Red Riding Hood? You know, and so when I pulled it down, we saw the big gash, and we all were like, The great part about that is hair grows back. But the thing is that in so many of our lives, because we're talking about transformation and what you need to be praying for, what it is that some of us, we have deceived ourselves and we go around with the same haircut saying, oh, look, I'm a superhero. You know, but you're not. Recognize the fact that you've got a bad haircut. But also recognize the fact that guess what? Hair grows back. Change is possible.
That's right.
That relationship can be restored. Live in faith. Live with a sense of expectation. Live with the sense that God is big enough to handle your issues. Live with this sense that guess what? I'm not perfect, but guess what? God is, and God can work this out.
Yes.
Stop trying to do it all. Stop trying to deceive yourself. Stop trying to hide it. Stop trying to make up a delusional behavior so that you can say, oh, I'm cool, I'm awesome, I'm amazing. No, you're not. We all know because we all see you. You're only fooling yourself. Matthew chapter 9, verse 27 through 30, it says, and as Jesus passed on from there, two blind men followed him, crying out, have mercy on us, son of David. When he entered the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said to them, do not believe that I am able to do this. Do you believe that I am able to do this? They said to him, yes, Lord. Then he touched their eyes, saying, according to your faith, let it be done. And their eyes were opened, and Jesus sternly warned them, see that no one knows about it. Okay, so here we go. This is Jesus, and this is the humor of this situation. Maybe you don't read the Bible the way that I read the Bible. That's okay, because God made me there this way. So back up, it's okay. All right, so the thing is, I'm reading the scripture. I see Jesus passes two blind men. Okay, now how funny is Jesus that these men, it says, they're calling out to him. And guess what Jesus is doing? Hey, watch this, disciples. I'm over here. Marco, Polo. Polo. You know, but they didn't get hyped up about that. What they said is they said Polo every time. You wonder why? Because they knew that they were blind. The scripture also tells that he enters into a house, so that means he's walking, not walking towards them, he's walking away from them, and guess what they did? Polo, 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 and you need to understand sometimes you've got to work for your transformation. Sometimes you gotta get up there, maybe you gotta get up early in the morning, maybe you gotta stay up late at night. Sometimes you gotta walk around your neighborhood even when other people are being crazy. Sometimes you gotta say things that other people aren't willing to say. Sometimes you gotta go places that other people aren't willing to go. Sometimes you need to take some extra steps, realizing the fact that Jesus is still there, and the fact that he keeps saying Polo or Marco, guess what? It still means he wanna do it, but I just gotta find him.
Right.
You know, I was talking to a coach yesterday. He's actually the academic director for one of the for the Catholic school inside of our area. And he told me, he goes, you know, the hardest team for us to develop leaders in or develop athletes in is in track. And he goes, I go, why? He goes, because it's a lot of work. Nobody wants to work. He said they went to a track meet the other day. And one of the tracks, you know, one of the races that normally you used to, when he was in high school, would be packed full of young people. This one only had two schools that had one participant in that, inside of that race. And he's like, he goes, it's as though people aren't willing to work for the things that need to happen inside of their body for them to actually be at an athletic level to compete. He goes, let me give you an example. He goes, one of the young men who throws disc for our thing was so happy that he threw it 50 feet. Or 75 feet, that's what he's doing, 75 feet. And he said, he goes, dude, why are you so happy? He goes, because I threw it 75 feet. I threw it 75 feet. He said, he looked at the boy and he said, you know what, when I was in high school, the girls threw it at 75 feet. And that's not a thing to dog girls, but it's a thing just to tell that young man that your accomplishment really is not an accomplishment, it is just one step towards an accomplishment. And the thing is that what we have to understand is sometimes as we step out in faith, what God is moving and doing inside of our lives is actually going to take more than one or two, three, four, five, maybe even 10 steps of faith for us to get to the place that God wants us to be. But guess what? When you get to that place, transformation takes place. When you get to that place and you turn around and you see all that God has done, you're like, oh my goodness, now I know why God made me do that small thing, because that small thing gave me the revelation to do the next small thing, which led to the next even maybe a little bit bigger thing. Maybe it was another small thing. Maybe it was something a little bit bigger than what I ever seen before. Then it was back to the small thing, and all of a sudden I turn around and I say, God, you brought me from a long way. God, you've given me the breakthrough. God, I'm that blind man, and guess what? I'm going to keep searching for you. I'm going to keep listening for you. God, I'm going to enter into the house where you're at. And then Jesus literally asks him a question and says, do you want to be healed? Jesus, are you reading the same story I'm reading? He says, do you want to see? And the thing is that I can lay out your issues right here. And I can ask you, do you really want to be delivered? Do you really want to stop getting into the wrong relationship? Do you really want to stop going out to the bar every single night? Do you really want to have a good marriage? Do you really want to stop being addicted to pornography or other issues like that? Do you really want to receive your healing? And the thing is, we see that Jesus says to them, and their response to Jesus is, yes, we do want to be healed. Yes, and he goes, according to your faith, be it done to you. And the thing is for us to see transformation, for us to cry out for the right thing, is that we have to be in a place where we're willing to be transformed ourselves. Do you believe that change is possible? Ask yourself that. Do you really believe change is possible? Or are you someone who believes inside of the modern, you know, tech or modern belief of what our society says? Even a great philosopher, a modern philosopher said by the name of Jay-Z, he says that the power of the authority of the church stops at the four walls. And I don't know about you, but I don't believe that. I believe that the greatest power, the greatest authority in which we have actually begins as we step out on those streets inside of Berkeley, as we step out in the streets of Oakland, as we set out in the streets in Richmond and the other parts of the Bay Area, that it's literally inside of that moment, because when we're inside of that moment, that's when we desperately need God. We desperately need God when we see people acting a certain way that they should not be acting. We desperately need God when we see young people fighting at the schools, throwing punches. And I'm not talking about like playing around. I just want real punches in the middle of their school, creating environments that are unsafe. Even this week, I saw this thing on Facebook of like this kid who scored 95% made honor roll, and people inside of this neighborhood beating them up. I don't know about you, but my heart was broken inside of that moment. Why? Because our young people need us to stand up as adults and literally be on their behalf, to show them a way that is different, to show them the fact that, guess what? That kid who got beat up, if he keeps going the way he's going, is going to make more money doing that than he actually is on the street doing other things. And the thing is we've got to lay it out for them that, yes, it's hard work. Yes, it's going to take effort. Yes, it's going to take, you know, you at times feeling like you're that blind person going, where you at, Jesus? Where you at? Where you at? Where you at? But when you find Jesus and you're ready to answer the question that, yes, I am ready to be healed. Yes, I do believe that it's possible, that there is deliverance. There's authority. There's a way in which you live your life. I mean, imagine you were born blind, but now you can see. Imagine the fact that the things that you never thought were possible, all of a sudden they become possible.
where people said you can't even buy a house in the Bay Area, and guess what? You got two or three of them. Not necessarily because you're just trying to get the house and trying to be, oh, it's all about me. No, it's because you're living such a blessed life and you believe in this thing. You believe in change. You believe that where people said you could never read, that guess what? Now you're reading. Where you believe that you would never get a certain type of job, that now you have that job. Where you believe that you would never dress this type of way and all of a sudden you're dressing that way. All of those things are external things that are indication of things that have transformed inside of your life. And the thing is that transformation is key, and I've got to hurry up because I got 2 minutes. Here we go, right here. The second thing. First thing is transform yourself. The second thing is salvation. Is you cry out for salvation. You cry out for others inside of the world. This is not just about you. This is not just about you. Let me repeat that again. This is not just about you. I put an example inside my book and I had no idea what the example is. Oh well, here we go. Next. Here we go. John chapter 3, verse 16. It says, "For God so loved the world." Think about that. For God so loved the world. What did he do? Okay, I know you guys all know what y'all said. But what I heard was... But I know what you guys said. You know, he gave Jesus his only begotten son. Therefore, God so loved the world. And my question to you is what are you willing to give up in order to show your love for the world? What are you willing to say no to? What are you willing to say yes to? You know, when you think outside of yourself, when you think past today, when you think past lunchtime, you think past maybe even the end of this week, what you begin to do is you begin to actually think generationally. And the thing is what sacrifices are you willing to make today so that the next generation doesn't have to deal with the things in which they deal with? You know, I remember I had a conversation with my oldest daughter, who's now 11, and really what we've always done is there's certain words that we say that we do not allow her to use. Right? We don't allow any of our kids to use. And one of those words is, "I can't." Like, I remember this is, okay, bear with me, okay? First child, years ago, it's already happened, she's already grown, and I feel as though she's somewhat normal and has acquaintances, all that type of stuff. You know, but I remember that we first, you know, when she would first start saying, "I can't," I just get mad. I just get frustrated. You know, and the guy kind of told me, that's not how you teach someone. I don't get mad and frustrated at you, so why get mad and frustrated at her? But whatever, okay? So, but in all that, is that we were adamant about her not saying it. You know, I mean, she was like, I can't do it. And we would say, "Yes, you can do it. Now say you can 20 times. I can do it, Dad. I can do it, Dad. I can do it, Dad. I can do it. I can do it. Don't get smart out with me. You can't do it." You know, just like all that. You know, but it's like, it's in that moment where we were trying to instill inside of her that, yes, you can. And so a few years ago, before we moved from Virginia, it's maybe about 3 years ago, we were in the car and we started talking about this whole idea about hunger. Started talking about food capacity. And you know, she at the time was like a fourth or fifth grade, so you can't really have like a deep conversation about it. But you can have a conversation. And wait, let me back up. Sometimes the conversations in which we have, if you can explain it to a little kid, then guess what? That's probably the heart of the issue. If you can't explain an issue to them, you might need to maybe back away from the issue and either get clarity about the issue, or maybe it's not even worth your time actually being upset about. But maybe that's just me because I'm simple, but whatever. But I'm talking to her about it, and she, this is what she said to me. She goes, "Dad, this problem is simple,
I said, is it really simple? And she goes, yeah, it's simple. What we need to do is we need to take our multitudes and get it to the people that have nothing. And I said, and I looked at her and I said, you're exactly right. You're exactly right. In my mind, in my analytical mind, is like, well, how do we do it? Well, let's do it. Let's do this. Let's do it. But I remember to her, remember I said, anything is possible. And the thing is that we right now are faced in situations inside of our communities all over this country, all over this world, that guess what? The simplest thing is, let me tell you what it is. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. It's simple. It's easy. It's only complicated because we make it complicated. It's only difficult because guess what? We make it difficult. Because ourselves get so much caught up inside the mix of things that what happens is that our anger begins to build up. Our participation of what we've experienced in the past begins to be there. All the things inside of our lives that we maybe have dealt with up until that time all of a sudden begin to pollute the equation. And so therefore it makes us hard to communicate. It makes us hard to deal with. It makes us hard to relate. It makes us hard to try to get into even the same room as the person that we need to be communicating with. You know, I remember when I first started pastoring, you know, I went to a not so diverse church. So I was like the token there. I was actually two tokens because I'm half Mexican and half black. So guess what? You got a black skin on staff. So guess what? We're getting two for the price of one. Okay. So that I'm just telling you how what their perspective was on it. So then as I'm there, you know, one of my assignments, one of the things I was charged to do was I was in part of the pastoral care team. So we handled all the pastoral care issues inside of a 5,000, 6,000 member church. Okay, so that's a lot of issues. We're always running around, hospital visits, all that type of stuff. Massive, okay? So a Jamaican lady happened to pass away. Family had been in the church for years, okay? And so I knew the family, but never had really like developed a relationship with this mom. She would like come in inside of a wheelchair, but she would be there like every Sunday, faithful. You know, at least the time when we were there, and I had been there for almost a year at this point, almost. And so the lady who actually divvied out the pastoral care stuff gives me a call and says, yeah, this lady has died, and because she's black and you're black, we're gonna have you do the funeral. And sometimes, you know, because my religion, I'm simple, so sometimes things have a hard time translating to actually what's there. And so, but I have a tendency to kind of shut down, okay? So I shut down and I was like, okay, all right, bye, hung up, right? But then the Holy Spirit began to speak to me and began to say, you need to talk to her about this, okay? So this is what I did. I waited until after one of our pastoral care meetings and I said, hey, can I talk to you for a minute? Nicely, calmly, and then said, hey, white lady, what you doing inside of my face? Why you gotta say this? You know what I mean? I didn't do all that. I said, hey, you know what, can me and you talk for a minute privately? You know, and so we went and we talked, and this is what I said to her. I said, I repeated exactly what I said to you, and guess what? Her reaction was the same exact that y'all had. Let me repeat that again. Her reaction was the same response that you guys had. Did I really say that? And I said, yeah, you did say that. I said, the thing is that you're not putting me down by making that type of statement. What you're doing is you're putting yourself down. Because you're putting yourself inside of a box saying that you can only minister to someone that looks like this. But I'm here to tell you that God is something bigger, God is something better, that God has an amazing path for you. And guess what? You can minister to people who look different than you do. And she sat there and all she did was cry. And I'm telling you, inside of our moments, inside of our times, not only are we to transform not only ourselves, but we are to transform our world. And that's how we transform our world. Luke chapter 19 verse 1 says, as when he drew near and saw the city, he wept over it. Do you weep over your city? Do you weep over the people inside your neighborhood? Do you weep over the people that are next door to you? Do you weep next to the people who are in the restaurant with you? Do you weep with the people that are at our mission? Do you weep with the people that are over at Realm? Do you weep with the people that are on that university? Do you weep for the people that God has placed you around? Because you are there not just to get an education. You are there to shine brightly for him. You are not there just to pick up a paycheck, but you are there inside of that moment to be an example of who Jesus is. See, the issue in the fact of what I'm talking about today
today is we've got to learn what to cry out for, how to cry out for it, when to cry out for it, where to cry out for it. I'm not telling you at your job to start weeping, oh Lord, what's wrong with you? I'm crying for you. No, no, don't be the crazy person, okay? Be the person in wisdom that before you go to work, the person that after you go to work, you cover your day in prayer, doing and moving forward. And here goes the last thing, 2 Timothy chapter 4:5, ask for you always, be sober-minded, enduring suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. Be sober. What else is that? It says, be sober-minded, endure suffering, so it's going to be hard. Do the work of evangelism. You might be saying, well, I'm not the person that kind of shares my faith. You know what? Just live your life and be normal. Not only be normal, but be someone who's approachable. And guess what? That might be what the work of evangelism is for you. Have a clean desk when you go to work so that when people are looking at you, they're not like, ugh, what's wrong with that? You know, iron your shirt, brush your teeth, go get a haircut if that's not the look that you're going for. You might be like, well, those are just servicing. No. Those are things that literally what it does is it opens up a door for people to say, they've got their life together. I know mine is jacked up, but what can I do now to get my life fixed? You might be saying, well, I don't know if that's going to work. Well, you know what? Just try it and see if it works. And then guess what? When you're at home, pray for an opportunity. Pray for the chance. Because the thing is if you're not crying out for it, guess what? God's not going to give it to you. Guess what? If you can have the, if you can, you know, let me just get started. I'll end with this. Coming back to the piano, so I'll make sure to be quiet. But I remember that we were at the mall, right? And there was this lady, and she was walking around with like this huge, you know, kind of like her leg was swollen, you know? And basically, it was swollen because of, you know, like just random things, and just a whole bunch of health issues, right? But she was very small and petite, but her leg was huge. So I'm looking at her, and then what happened was I saw her husband. Her husband was her husband, but describing her, that's not her picture, but whatever. And so what happened was at the mall, I was like, man, I really feel like I want to talk to them. You know, I really feel like I want to, you know, share something with them, right? And so I kept praying, but we never crossed paths. Like, literally, I saw them, they couldn't ask me, and I was going up that stair. Then later on, I saw them, the opposite, same thing too. You know, kind of like weird. So you're not like weird to have a conversation. Hey, Jesus loves you. Hey, go down there. You know, no, don't do that weird stuff, okay? Don't do it, okay? Do not be weird and do stuff like that, okay? So what happened was I just began to pray. I mean, God, man, it'd be great to have them in the church. God, I pray that, God, that you would do something, you know, just whatever, blah, blah, blah. So I think the next day was church. And guess who was at church? They were sitting here in church. You know, and so when they were there, I was like, you know what? You know what, you guys? We prayed for you guys to be in church. And all of a sudden, they began to cry. They began to weep. And I was like, well, what's wrong? You know, later on, after not in church, hey, why are you crying? You know, you're not part of the message. Hey, why are you crying? You know, and I wasn't like that. But what they began to share with me is all the hurt and the pain that they experienced from other churches, the hurt and pain in which they even knew how they were living their lives was causing that. And they needed to be in an environment that would generate change in their life. They needed to be inside of an environment where they felt loved, where they felt wanted, where they felt, you know, that they could and that they should get up the next morning. And the thing is we live in a world that is dying. We live in a world that is falling apart. And if you don't believe that, you're probably falling apart with it. Because you're probably condoning most of the things in which our society is doing. And you don't have to even walk too far even out of this walls in order to see some of the effects of people's lives who have put things before God. And maybe you stand here today as one of those people and you're kind of like, I'm here, you know, I need to get it right. And I just want to let you know. But guess what? Jesus is passing by. And what will you do? Will you just say, oh, great message. Teddy's awesome. Teddy's passionate. Guess what, Teddy? All that stuff is good for him. But for me, you know, I don't know. And my question to you, just as Jesus' question to the two blind men was, do you want to be healed?
And I don't know what it is that you're going through today, and I'm not going to ask you to come up here individually and begin to share with me. But if you are someone and you really feel like, you know what, I'm like that blind person. I'm ready to cry out to Jesus for transformation either in my own life, or in the transformation of my city, the transformation of my neighborhood, the transformation of just period my family. I'm going to ask you just as a sign of faith. We're going to go into a song in a little while, but I'm not going to call you to the front, but this is what I will call you to do. I will call you to stand right where you're at. And just as Phil sings this next song, that you stand up in faith and you just begin to lift up your hands and you begin to pray. You begin to cry out for that situation. That you begin to stand right where you're at. And you begin to lift up your hands and you begin to say, Jesus, I lift her up to you. Jesus, I lift up my kid to you. Jesus, I lift up my city to you. That you just begin to cry out to Jesus. And I believe that breakthrough is going to happen. Because I believe that as what you are doing is that you are following after Jesus. And then you're going inside the house. That you're pursuing him. And so just as Phil, just begin to pray. And stand up in faith. Come on. If that's you.